Well, the title of the book is The Usefulness of Useless Knowledge. And it makes the point that if you have research that's really driven by curiosity, by the deep need to understand, you make progress that is incredibly effective and can really transform our world. And I would even argue that to really make these kind of major changes, you need kind of an intellect and a drive that really comes within, mm-hmm. just the just wanting to know.
Yeah. And are there any examples sort of throughout history of key mathematicians that have sort of had this drive and had this creative intellect?
Well, it's kind of funny. There was a Dutch chemist, Van het Hof, who was the first Nobel Prize winner, and he made a list of mathematicians who have imagination, so interest in the arts, and not. But you also had a third category with mathematicians with too much imagination, who were interested in alchemy and astrology.
Yeah.
And actually, if you look at that list, you find Newton, Leibniz, Descartes, all the great names. So I think that's very telling. I think somebody like Newton, it was famously said, I think, by the astronomer Lagrange, that he must be the happiest person who have ever lived, because only one can be the first to discover that there's a system behind the world. And if there's a system behind mechanics and the planets, why isn't there also a system in psychology or chemistry? And indeed, you can make gold out of lead. It only takes a particle accelerator.
And we're standing here next to a portrait of Michael Faraday.
Faraday, yes.
Yes, who, of course, was involved in the invention and the discovery of electricity and the equations that modeled electricity. Did this come from an application, or was this idea of useless research?
Totally useless. Faraday was really playing with magnets and electric currents. And there's this kind of famous story that William Gladstone, who at that point was the Chancellor of the Exchequer, came to visit him in his lab and asked, where is this all good for? And Michael Faraday said, I have no idea, but one day, sir, you may tax it. And indeed he did. Because now, actually, I would say 100% of our lives, of our economy, is governed by electricity. But it's amazing the first time the electric light bulb was switched on, actually by Thomas Edison, in the editorial room of the New York Times. It didn't on the front page say, Age of Electricity Starts. It was actually on page 8, a very small piece. Electric lights, they're like gas lights, but they don't smell.
Yeah. And just going back to Faraday and Maxwell's equations of electromagnetism, could you tell us a little bit about those and sort of what they represent?
Well, the wonderful thing of that early stage of the development of electromagnetism is, of course, Maxwell's realization that it actually is describing light, that are just a simple set of equations, they easily fit on a T-shirt, describe not only light, but every form of electromagnetic radiation. So in some sense, you look at the rainbow, but you don't realize that electromagnetic spectrum goes all the way to radio waves or to X-rays. So there's this incredible unification of all phenomena around us, all given by this simple equation. If only Maxwell had patented that equation, we would kind of be paying an infinity of all basic research in the world. And actually, you can make that point that in some sense, there's many technological innovations that, of course, build radio, build television signals, ultraviolet, etc. But if Maxwell wouldn't have been able to kind of synthesize the work of Faraday and others, and in this very simple, elegant form, with an astonishing beauty, I feel. Mm-hmm. Maxwell equations are just lovely. It would never have happened. So it's the spark that lit the fire.
One of the most, I think, famous sort of discoveries that just came from pure curiosity came through the work of Einstein and his theory of relativity. And this, most people have heard of it, but don't realize just how important, how applicable it is to our daily lives.
So Einstein had kind of a fresh look at space and time. And I think before Einstein, space was like a stage on which everything happens. And time, well, there was only one time. There was like a big clock that was ticking. And then he showed, actually, first of all, that the stage is like flexible, that space can be curved, that if you put something like the Earth in space, it curves space. And in fact, it also curves time. So time itself, which we think as universal, it's not. Basically, everybody If you're moving fast or slow, you have your own clock. And all these clocks are different. 100 years ago, these were minute effects, much too small to directly measure. But nowadays, in our high-tech world, these kind of microseconds, they matter. And for instance, our GPS system, which is using satellites orbiting the Earth, because they are moving in a gravitational field and they're moving at high speed, Einstein's equations are incredibly relevant. It's a matter of, I think, like 32 microseconds, but it translates, if, in terms of your GPS, of like 7 miles a day. So I like to say, without Einstein, we all would be lost.
Yeah.
We wouldn't have met here. We would be somewhere else in London. In fact, the beautiful thing is that Einstein's equation itself, again, fits easily on a T-shirt. And so the math is able to capture all this in two symbols. And roughly the equation look like A equal B, where A is the curvature of space and time, and B is matter and energy positioned in the universe. So he again was able to capture all of that, the philosophical thinking, the practical applications, in a single line.
I think that's a really nice way of, like, nice criteria of judging how good a mathematical theory is, if it fits on a T-shirt.
Exactly, I would say so, yeah. And also, often I like to point out that, you know, if you take a mathematical equation, like Einstein's equations or Maxwell's, indeed they look like A equal B. And the most important part in the equation is actually the equal sign, because it's relating two things that you didn't even thought were related. Like, take E equals mc squared, the most famous equation in physics. It's equating energy and mass. Before Einstein, these were a separate concept. But because they are put in one equation, certainly I can take mass and create energy out of it, like in a nuclear explosion. Or if I get energy, like I'm moving, my mass increases, like with a millionth of a percent, but still it does. And so I think that role of mathematics in connecting concepts, connecting ideas, connecting people, is incredibly powerful. So I think this equal sign really captures for me the essence of mathematics. And one thing I find also very astonishing, that, you know, almost to the day, a century after his discovery of these field equations, we detected here the gravitational waves. Mm-hmm. And that also shows that some of these long-term research efforts, they take more than a single lifetime. When Einstein passed away in 1955, his theory was celebrated as a piece of art. That's like the worst thing to say about a scientific theory. It was beautiful, philosophical, but had no applications. And now, of course, it's everywhere around us.